I'm fighting a bit of a cold, so I probably won't shake people's hands as we go out the back here. I'll wave to you, but I just don't want to spread anything in case I might have something that's spreadable. I think that's probably why I'm going to use this as an excuse why I put on my navy blue jacket with my black pants. It's got to be the cold, right? So, yeah, let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you for loving us, watching out over us. We know, Lord, that we who are keepers of the gospel, those who have heard the good news of great joy, who have obeyed that gospel, who are living it faithfully, we are the keepers of light. We hold that light out to a dark world around us who desperately needs to hear and obey that gospel. Father, help us to sift through in our minds and our hearts what is truly truth and your scripture, and what are the traditions that we have wrapped the gospel in, that we, ways of thinking, ways of doing things that we've grown up with, that we have equated with truth in our minds, but in truth, there's only the gospel that is truly truth. Help us, Lord, not to trouble those of younger generations, those who have never attended church, those who are coming from difficult family life situations and circumstances that need to hear the hope that is being held out in that gospel that we can offer them and would obey it and live it out if it weren't for everything else that we try to add to the gospel. Help us, Lord, to truly be good children for you as we love the lost around us as much as we have loved your Son, and your Son has loved us by dying for us upon the cross. It's through him that we pray and offer thanks. Amen. Again, we've had a number of lessons in the book of Acts, and right about number 5 there, you can see that Peter has been working with the first Gentile converts to Christianity. That began in Acts chapter 10 with the figure of Cornelius. And from there, after he was questioned about why he did that, and it was shown that it was God who opened the door to the Gentiles, we see that suddenly the Gentiles began pouring into that first century church. What an amazing time it was. From there, we saw number 6 there that Paul and Barnabas really began to work with the church in Antioch. And some of those first Christians who had been scattered from the great persecution in Jerusalem way back at the beginning of Acts chapter 8 were some of the ones who were working with the new Gentile Christians who were coming to the gospel through faith. And Paul, who had been the persecutor of those Christians, was working side by side, elbow to elbow, with them in Antioch for the cause of the gospel. What an amazing time it was, God bringing people from very diverse backgrounds, many of whom were coming into the church from that Gentile background, that pagan background. They really didn't know anything about who God was or the old law or the priesthood or the temple or anything of that nature. They only had a background in paganism. And yet Paul was working with them along with Barnabas and others to try to teach them the gospel and have them obey it. So we saw last time Peter's release from prison, the church's prayer, and so forth. Today we're going to be looking at a new struggle that's coming along here, and that's Paul and Barnabas returning from their first missionary journey and finding out that there are Judaizers, or those who are Christians, but from a Jewish background, who are trying to make it difficult for these new Christians from a Gentile background to obey the gospel and live faithfully, because they said, no, You got to accept all the trappings and traditions that we have built up over the years from our culture and so forth before you can become a Christian. And this was having a hard effect on the early church, as we see there. And so, as I said, it began with Cornelius and Peter going to the home of Cornelius and baptizing he and his whole household. And it says a little bit later on, after Peter was questioned about that, that those who had been scattered by the persecution traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who had come into Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists also. These would be those from a Greek background, those of a Gentile background, preaching the Lord Jesus, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The church, as we've said in other previous lessons, had a hard struggle with this, a hard problem with this. How do they deal with people flooding into the church who have various backgrounds, and what do they do with it? Not everybody was happy. These Judaizers were the ones who were not happy about this. It continues saying the church in Jerusalem, when they heard about this, they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. He sees that God has allowed these Gentiles from a Gentile background by faith to come into the gospel, to obey it and to live faithfully before Christ, even though they weren't knowledgeable of any of the background that the Jews had at all. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people, and in Antioch the disciples were first called Christians. They did so sending, there was a famine, and they sent a gift to Jerusalem by the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. So Barnabas and Saul were well acquainted with the church in Jerusalem. You know, Saul, of course, had a very rocky relationship with them at first, but once they realized that he was a true brother, that relationship thawed quite a bit. That's Acts chapter 11. Acts chapter 13 and 14, I've got water here if my voice gives out. Acts chapter 13 and 14, we see that Paul and Barnabas go on their first missionary journey, really to the interior of Galatia or Asia Minor at that time. We can see when they returned, they strengthened the churches that were there. And when they got back to Antioch, as you can see there on the map, way over to the side over there, he wrote a letter to the Galatians, and there he deals with a new problem, and it's these Judaizers who have sprung up within the churches there in Galatia, and he's going to find that they are back in Antioch at home as well when he gets there. These are Christians from a Jewish background who don't seem to accept these Gentile converts to Christianity and are trying to enforce Jewish customs, traditions, the law upon them, saying you've got to become a good Jew first before you can become a Christian. And this is quite a problem for the church. And so the church at Antioch is once again going to send Paul and Barnabas to Jerusalem to find out how is it that we deal with this struggle. So that's what we're going to be speaking about today, is how it is that we, dealing with a brand new Gentile population, folks who don't attend church, and some of these younger generations around us who are still hungry for some kind of hope in their lives, as we hold out that hope to them with the gospel, how is it that we won't trouble them in turning to the Lord by insisting that they become Christians like folks way back in the 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s had to do in order to become Christians? How is it that we don't impose the trappings and traditions, the packaging that we put around the gospel for them to become Christians first? How is it we can only hold out the pure gospel to them and not trouble them in turning to God? But first of all, what's really going on with the Gentiles? You see, a door had been opened to them, a door that had always been closed because they had never been part of the covenant relationship with God. And suddenly, with Cornelius in Acts chapter 10 and following, we see that God has indeed opened a door for them. At the end of the Christians in Jerusalem questioning Peter about what did you do it with Cornelius' household, it says, here's their conclusion, then to the Gentiles also, God has granted repentance that leads to life. That's their conclusion. As we see Paul going forth and speaking to a largely Gentile audience in Athens, there in the Areopagus, Mars Hill, he is speaking to them, and he says this, and we can gain some clues from his message to them about what it is that was truly important to these folks who had no background whatsoever in Judaism. He says, the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, we will hear you again about this. You see, in some ways, Paul, as he is the apostle to the Gentiles, and he's going out to those who have no background whatsoever in Judaism or the law or the priesthood or the temple or sacrifices or anything there, he boils Christianity down to the gospel message that they need to obey. He removes all the traditions, all of the religious trappings, and he says, these are the things that you need to know. To the Gentiles, he said, God exists. He says, God used to overlook ignorance, but he is no longer going to do that because his Son has now come, and his Son has now died for you on your behalf, shedding his blood for you, so that his blood can forgive your sins. He says there's a call to repent, and he issues that call to them to turn away from their sinful way of life, their way in which is against what God wants for them, change their heart, change their life, change their attitude, that God will judge all. He's not going to listen to any kind of excuses. He's not entertaining the idea that I didn't know. Ignorance is no longer an excuse for anybody in mankind anywhere in the world. God is going to judge, and you need to make sure that you are right with him and that Jesus overcame death by his work on the cross. That was Paul's message to a completely Gentile audience in Athens on Mars Hill. And so we can gain an understanding here as we look out at a Gentile world around us that needs to be won from Christ, for Christ, how it is that we are to reach out with the gospel and not include any of our traditions or trappings that we have built up over the decades that are largely of a Western 20th century packaging that we put upon the gospel, that we're trying to insist that these newer generations who know nothing of church or churchology, the language of church that we use to say, I don't know anything about that. I can't become like that because I don't think that way. I don't work that way. What can we do? You see, we have something special. We offer hope to a world that doesn't know hope, and they are desperately hungry for it. You see, every other religion in the world, the blood flows from man to God. If only, they say, if I can be good enough, if I can catch my God's attention enough, then somehow I can go and be with Him one day. This was all the idols, all the pagan teachings that the world in the first century knew, but I would also argue it's what our world today knows as well, as they have made for themselves idols of self and success and leisure and hedonism and materialism and all these things where they're searching for hope, but they really don't offer any hope. You see, first century Christians understood this, that the gospel was different because the blood didn't flow from man to God. Instead, in Christianity, the blood flowed from God to man, as God became one of us and then went willingly to the cross to die for us so that our sins could be forgiven. Only in Christianity is hope offered. We have this promise of hope, and Hebrews chapter 6 speaks of it. It says, so when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of His purpose, He guaranteed it with an oath, that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for hope might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf. You see, we have fled for refuge. We have fled from this world to grab on to the hope, the only hope offered to mankind. And we understand this, we have obeyed this, we have fled to grab hold of it, and there are others outside of here who are searching for it. And we know what that hope is and hold it out in the gospel of Christ. I would argue today that the Gentiles of this world that we're working with today are really secular pagans. They wouldn't say they believed in any kind of a God, but when it gets right down to it, they worship the idols of self and of sinfulness, of hedonism and materialism and all of these things that they have built up where they try to find some sense of belonging and worth. And they're grabbing onto these things and not finding hope in them, but finding despair and discouragement all the while looking at what it is that we're doing as being so fuddy-duddy and out of date, and they don't understand, I can't worship God that way, I don't know if I even believe in God. And what we're really trying to say to them is, we have hope. And what you're doing doesn't have hope. So to these Gentiles, we need to give the same gospel that Paul gave in Athens, that God exists, that He won't overlook ignorance any longer. There's a call to repent, to give up of, and sin does exist, and you need to turn away from that and obey the gospel, that because God is going to judge all, and that Jesus overcame death through His work on the cross. And this is the only thing that gives hope to mankind. See, that's where we need to be as a church, as keepers of hope. So what's really going on with the Judaizers in the first century? See, the Judaizers are Christians, but they have an old background, a background of in the church that is from the old style of doing things, which was of a Jewish background in that first century. And these Gentiles that are coming in, they think differently. They do things differently. And there are some among these older style Christians who are saying to themselves, until they can think and do things like we think and do things, they really can't become Christians. And so here in Acts chapter 15, our main passage, in the first few verses of that passage, it says, but some men came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. That was the message that was coming into Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas had just come back from their first missionary journey. And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and the elders about this question. But some believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees in Jerusalem rose up and said, it is necessary to circumcise them and to order them to keep the law of Moses. So in Antioch, they've got struggle with some of these holding on to the old traditions and ways. And when they get to Jerusalem, you've got some from the party of the Pharisees who are also saying you've got to hold to the old traditions and ways. They've got to follow them first. They've got to think like us. They've got to do things like us before they can become Christians. Jesus ran into the struggle. In Matthew chapter 15, you can see what Jesus encountered from perhaps some of these same Pharisees who later obeyed the gospel. I don't know if they were or not. It says, then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? You see, whatever group they belong to, you always develop traditions and ways of doing things, the packaging around the main message. They break the tradition of the elders, for they do not wash their hands when they eat. He answered them, and why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? For God commanded, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if anyone tells his father or mother, what you would have gained from me is given to God, he need not honor them. See, Jesus points out the truth here that when we insist not on Scripture, of course, we ought to insist on Scripture, ought to insist on the gospel, but when we insist on the packaging that's wrapped around that gospel, the traditions, the ways of doing things, and we say you've got to do those before you can become a Christian, then what we're doing is violating the commandment of God. We're breaking the commandment of God if we're forcing those traditions. That's why I think as soon as Paul got back from his first missionary journey and he's in Antioch there and he's hearing that, hey, some of these Judaizers that are here now in Antioch and are causing some stir, they're also coming into some of the churches we just established. Is Satan going to kill all of those, the faith of all those new Christians that are there in Iconium and Lystra and Derbe and Pergamum and all those different places where he went? And so he writes the letter to the Galatians, and he really comes down on some of these Judaizers. And he says here, look, I, Paul, say to you that if you accept circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. If you insist that they follow your Jewish traditions, then Christ will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law. You have fallen away from grace, for through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love. And so here we see, after Paul and Barnabas go down to Jerusalem, after they speak with the apostles and the elders and the leading men there about this issue and what is it we're going to do, and some of the Pharisees who have obeyed the gospel and are now Christians, but they come from that Jewish background and they're insisting, yes, they must be circumcised in order to become Christians. They must think like we do the things that we do, act like we do in order to follow Christ. James stands up in the council and quotes Old Testament and says, after this I will return and I will rebuild the tent of David that has fallen. I will rebuild its ruins and I will restore it, that the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord. And all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who makes these things known from of old. Therefore, my judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God. Whatever translation it was in our scripture reading, it says, do not make it difficult for the Gentiles who turn to God. Don't insist on all of the trappings and traditions, the packaging that worked for baby boomers and Gen Xers and perhaps some of the millennials, but isn't working for the rest of the millennials and the Gen Zs who don't attend church, who are lost out in the world, who need desperately to find hope. But we should write, and he gives them that gospel message, very similar to what Paul delivered in Athens. For from ancient generations, Moses has had in every city those who proclaim him, for he is read every Sabbath in the synagogues. We are keepers of the gospel. Are we making it difficult? Are we troubling those of the Gentiles in the world around us who are trying to turn to God, who are desperately needing hope, by insisting that they think and act like we do first? What really must go on with the church? First of all, we can't have an us-them mentality. Romans chapter 3 tells us, what then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we've already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. We need to understand that we, too, are sinners in need of God's grace. That also those outside here are sinners, also in need of God's grace. We may be a little farther down the path of salvation than they are. They're not even on that path, but we don't have any special advantage over them, really. We're dead in our sins. As it continues here, we can see also that not only have we sinned and separated our own selves from God, but they have as well. It says their feet are swift to shed blood and their paths are ruin and misery. This describes you, it describes me, it describes them. And the way of peace they have not known. There's no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin. It's that justification that we're trying to get to, because we all, you, me, those out there, are being held accountable for the sins that we have done. We've separated ourselves from God. We have earned death by what we have done. And we, sitting here in this audience, listening to us online, are keepers of that gospel. We must proclaim it, not keep it to ourselves. And so do we proclaim it? Do we tell them of the righteousness, the justification that is possible only through Christ on the cross, that is available to all? As we continue in Romans chapter 3, it says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Christ, Jesus Christ, for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. The gospel offers hope. It's the only thing that offers hope to a world that desperately needs hope. And verse 26 wraps it up by saying this: this was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. And so our conclusion needs to be the same that they concluded at that Jerusalem council in Acts chapter 15. Should we insist that they think like we do, that they do the things that we do, that they wrap the gospel in the same packaging that worked for us? Or are we going to trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God? Do we do that by our insistence? How is it that we cannot trouble them? We need to realize that today's Gentiles desperately need hope. That's what they need. That's what they need. And they're seeking for that hope in things that do not have hope. They think and do things differently than us. We need to understand that. Sometimes we scratch our heads and say, I don't understand this younger generation. I don't know why they do the things that they do and why they do it that way. It doesn't make any sense to me. And then I hand them my phone or tablet or computer or something, and what do? I'm like, how'd you do that? I don't think that way. We think differently than they do. We can't insist that they think and do things like we do. And that we, as keepers of the gospel that never changes, that truth that never changes, that we're told to hold out to a crooked and perverse generation, that we, as keepers of that gospel, must offer them the only hope that is offered to mankind, and that is through that gospel. In closing, secular pagans today don't reject hope. They reject forced traditions. They reject old church packaging around the gospel. We must not be today's Judaizers. We must not trouble those who are trying to turn to God, who want hope when we have it to offer. Instead, we must hold out the gospel to them, never changing that at all, but always pointing them to the Savior who went to the cross on our behalf, who died for us and was risen for our eternity. If this is you and you've never obeyed that gospel, if you've never realized the hope that is there in that gospel, and you want to know more about it, you want to obey it, there are those here today who will help you do that. If you have done that perhaps years ago and you realize that you've been a modern-day Judaizer, insisting on traditions and packaging that is no longer relevant to a world that needs hope, and you want the prayers, the encouragement of the church as you go forth with the gospel message to a new generation who needs to hear it, perhaps this is an opportunity for you to come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation.
By faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the light.